on part one of this video, we took a look at the force time curve from a counter movement jump, breaking down some of the different phases in the jump and looking at it with some real VALD performance ForceDecks data. Now, in this video, I'm going to dive even deeper into the shape of the force time curve and discuss some of the categories that have been discussed in the literature and applied practice when we are looking at these types of curves. If you haven't met me before, I'm Jo Clubb. I am a founder and sports science consultant at Global Performance Insights, working as a sports scientist to teams, athletes, and practitioners all around the world. And I've been collaborating with VALD on this athlete testing series to discuss different types of tests, technology, and metrics that you can use when assessing your athlete's physical capacities. This kind of a jump is classed as a unimodal jump. That's where there's this single bump, if you like, on the force time curve. And that is in contrast to a bimodal jump, where we have these two bumps in our takeoff. So there's actually quite a lot of debate about what the shape of these curves actually mean for performance and for strategy. That unimodal curve with the single clean peak, some believe represents an efficient movement strategy and is seen in well-trained athletes. We've got then the bimodal shape with two curves, which is commonly separated into primary and secondary, or early and late, depending on whether the first curve is the higher magnitude force or the second curve. So with bimodal primary, that first peak being higher, perhaps the athletes are rating early, relying on their acceleration and their strength in that eccentric phase, as opposed to then the bimodal secondary, where the second peak is greater. Perhaps this is more of a delayed push-off or a segmented push-off, could be a bit of a timing, a coordination issue in transitioning from the eccentric phase into the concentric phase. And actually, we can dive even deeper within unimodal and bimodal. So we have a study by Helen Bain, who classified the different kinds of force time curve shapes into these five different categories: unimodal early, when the peak came earlier on; unimodal late, where the peak came later on; and then in our bimodal, this is split into three types: symmetrical, where the two curves are relatively similar in terms of their magnitude, as opposed to a bimodal high to low, where the first curve is a greater magnitude, as opposed to bimodal low to high, where the second curve is of greater magnitude. So here we have an example then of this, again, unimodal force time curve, where there is just this single curve during the takeoff, collectively between the eccentric and the concentric phase, as opposed to this example, where clearly we have kind of a bimodal jump here, and this is one of those high to low or early bimodal jumps, where the highest peak force is coming during that eccentric phase, as opposed to this example, where we do have more of a bimodal curve and certainly a late bimodal curve, where the peak force is coming much later on in the takeoff phase as the individual is propelling themselves upwards. Contrast that then with this example here, where we have a bimodal shape. We do probably want to remove this trial because of this irregularity here with the unloading and the start of the movement. But I think this is an interesting trial to look at, given that we've got a different sequence really between the left and the right sides, whereby there's a bimodal shape on the right side, but less extreme on that left-hand side with the blue curve then. Although in this second rep, where we have a much better standing phase here, then we see actually a similar shape and quite clearly a bimodal shape to the force time curve. So what do these different shapes in terms of bimodal and unimodal and all the different categories within them mean? Unfortunately, research so far has been quite inconclusive on whether one or the other is better for countermovement jump performance. Some researchers suggest that the bimodal curve is linked to improved outcomes, whereas others suggest that it is a reflection of an inefficient use of the stretch shortening cycle. Helen Bain's research, which I mentioned earlier, with their different five different categories, found no clear performance differences between the unimodal and the bimodal strategies. Actually, that research suggests that it wasn't so much about the curved modality, but more about the timing of peak force, which seems to have a bit more evidence base behind it. Some research has shown that optimal jump performance occurs when peak force is generated near the transition from that eccentric to the concentric phase. And in Helen's research, the early concentric force peaks were most common and appeared to be the preferred strategy. I've seen other discussions around that these different shapes represent different types of athletes, some about being more elastic, about how they utilize their connective tissue. I'm not certain yet that we have a strong enough evidence base to group certain athletes based on these shapes, but of course, open to seeing and reading more research in this topic. And as well, we're getting more and more research using force displacement curves, which is another discussion that I'll save for another day. So as often is the case with force plates and with jump testing, I don't think it's a case necessarily of there being a best strategy. I think, again, it depends is perhaps the answer. But I think that there is still value in getting comfortable with these different shapes of force time curve, and as well as looking at the outputs of a jump on the VALD hub, actually going into the raw data and looking visually at the force time curves. Think if you can understand for your athletes their preferred strategy and shape in terms of looking within different trials, so within the same testing session, how consistent was the athlete's strategy, as well as then getting a sense of that over time. And we can then start to combine that with our strategy metrics and start to assess whether we think there are changes in how our athletes are jumping, which may relate to fatigue, training outcomes, and of course, may be very valuable as well in injury and rehabilitation. So I hope this video has given you more confidence to look at the underlying force time curve itself, and just start to dive into that with your athlete's data and get a sense of the different shapes and curves that you're seeing with your cohort. I want to thank VALD for sponsoring this video and again this whole series, and remind you that they have put together some excellent practitioner's guides to different topics, including two available now on force plates, a relatively new intermediate level of force plates, and they are available completely free to download from their website, which I'll put a link to below. And I hope you found this video useful. If you did, please like and subscribe so you don't miss out on another Sports Science Insights video coming very soon.